Hey, everybody, this is Ernie Johnson. You're about to watch a hashtag NBA Together episode featuring Masai Ujiri, the president of the Toronto Raptors. Had a great time talking to him about his road to the NBA, about winning an NBA title, and he has lots of wisdom to share. We recorded that conversation earlier today, and then about 3 hours after that, we got the word that Karl-Anthony Towns of the Minnesota Timberwolves had lost his mother, Jacqueline, to complications from the coronavirus. We wanted to let you know that so that as Masai and I had our discussion, it wouldn't be mentioned. And that's the reason why. The time that we had recorded our conversation, the news had not yet broken about Karl-Anthony Towns' mother, Jacqueline. All we can do is send our best to the family. The loss is unexplainable, and it's, you know, what Karl-Anthony Towns is dealing with right now, can't even comprehend. So we send love and good thoughts and prayers to Karl-Anthony Towns and his family at this incredibly difficult time. Love you, brother. Well, welcome to another edition of hashtag NBA Together. I'm Ernie Johnson, again coming to you from lovely Braselton, Georgia, about 45 minutes north of the city of Atlanta. And let's see. Last week we had the commissioner, Adam Silver, and we had Damian Lillard joining us. And we do this a couple times a week, talking to the influential voices of the NBA. And today, I cannot wait to get this conversation started with Masai Ujiri, the president of the Toronto Raptors, who's got a fascinating story to tell. And Masai, number one, thanks a lot for spending 3 hours with us. That's such a commitment you've made. That's really nice of you. actually, more like a half hour. But
I would do anything to spend those 3 hours with you, Ernie. Such a pleasure to be on. Thank you for having me.
No, it's great to see you. Great to talk to you. And I guess there are so many places I want to go with this, and I've been, and we'll get there eventually through different paths. But I guess the first way to start is just to ask how you, your wife and two kids, your parents in Africa, how's everybody doing?
You know, well, everybody is holding up, you know, with this such unprecedented times and very, very uncertain. Ernie, but you know what? We thank God for health. We thank God for being together. We thank God we're here to fight this this battle all together. And this is an unknown. And the best part of this, I know everybody says, is spending the time with family. You know, like, and maybe. Maybe we needed to slow down a little bit in the world, you know, like maybe we were going a little bit too fast and this was a calling, but we're just all trying to adjust to the everyday of what the new normal is going to be.
Yeah. How were you able to keep in contact, and how much contact do you have with the members of the Raptors, see what they're doing during this time and kind of keeping everybody up to speed on maybe where the league might be headed, even though we don't really know right now?
Well, it's funny, Ernie, the work has even been more. I don't know if it's because everything is on the phone, you know, like, but we're constantly, I am constantly on the phone with whether you're making contact with your staff, whether it's your leadership group, whether it's the coaching staff, whether it's the players, the league, ownership. There's so many phone calls, so many web calls, so many Zoom calls, you know, that we're taking part. So it's a 5-6 hour a day, but contact with players, with the team, it's been great, you know, like it's been more. Maybe we needed this, you know, to really interact in some kind of way where we're really checking up on each other, right? You know, we're checking up on people's families, how they are doing, health, and it's constant, you know. So Everybody is different. You have different relationships with different people, right? And I'm close to everybody in my organization. I make it, you know, you make it a priority to know everybody's story, to know what everybody is about. And the contacts have been great. My leadership team have been incredible, from Nick Nurse to Bobby Webster, Teresa Rush, Dan Tolsman. The town halls we're organizing, Ernie, the leadership calls, and then all the committees we serve on, you know, whether it's the MBA or boards or ownership or my organization, MLSC in general. So plenty of work, and then some of the political work and diplomatic work we try to do, and charity work that chimes in too. But we do it from here, and it's a pleasure to be in this time with a big family.
Yeah. Okay. I want total honesty on this answer. Not that you haven't been totally honest already. 46 a 46-18 record as play was suspended, as the season was suspended. A 46-18 record. Where did you? Are you surprised that you had the same record this season that you had in the regular season through 64 games in your championship year? Total honesty.
You know, Ernie, honestly, like from the inside, you try to keep your mouth shut, you know, like, you know how we are in the NBA, you know, karma, and you just want to keep going, you know. But honestly, with our coaching staff, with the group we had, and then somehow you hope your talent rises, you know, like the young players rise and players step up, you know, with Kawhi leaving, and that's all they did, you know, like, is step up, and they were better. They fought, and they were innovative. I think coach has an incredible mind in how he thinks the game. I think the rise of Pascal. And how about Kyle Lowry? I don't know. Yeah. Like, it's almost reversed. You know, like, it's basically the older he becomes, the better he becomes. Is how it's become. And then all the other guys. Fred has become such a great, wonderful guard in this league. Norman Powell has stepped up. It's the team has great courage. You know, and they fight. And yes, there's something to prove almost to the whole world, but we're on a stage where we took pride in defending the title, and I'm proud of these guys for really taking pride in doing that.
Yeah, you are the reigning champions, and if you had to list them, Masai, what are the characteristics that make a championship team or a championship organization?
Well, you know, it starts from the top. You know, we all say, you know, like ownership, leadership, culture. You have to be tough. You have to be resilient. You have to be creative. I can just keep going down the line. Mental toughness, you know, because the season is so up and down. The playoffs is so up and down. And to really build on that championship mode and that championship team, there has to be camaraderie. There has to be understanding. There has to be the passion to win. Yeah, you have to want to win. You know, some players play for each other. Sometimes we get. Sometimes, you know, I don't think it comes from a bad place, but there is some kind of selfishness sometimes. You know, like, you have to be selfless to win a championship. You know, the selfishness has to come from what you have to do for that team, and the will to win. Because, Ernie, we can say all what we want, you know, sports is about winning. Yeah, we play sports to win. And we bring people together, we organize, and we try to make the world a better place, the showcase of what these athletes do and what the NBA even does as a whole. But sports is about competing. It's about winning. And we had guys that wanted to compete and wanted to win.
It helps every now and then when you get a ball that bounces four times before it drops in a game seven. as you got from Kawhi against the Philadelphia 76ers, I was interested to note that like others in your position in various sports, it's very tough for you to sit and watch a game in one place. You kind of move around, correct? And so when Kawhi's shot fell against the Sixers, you were in the arena, but you weren't courtside. Where were you?
That's a great one. So I do move around, and I went to my office on the 15th floor, and I was watching the fourth quarter there by myself. And sometimes I watch it on my phone. Sometimes I'll move around and watch it on the screen. And when it was 91-86, Ernie, I decided to come down on the elevator because I thought, okay, hopefully this is going our way. I lose service and I get down the elevator and I'm walking on the corridor. And you won't believe what I saw. From the corridor, I saw a press room, and there's two guys sitting down, and I could see their lips. And I couldn't see the TV. It was too far off, and it was in the corner. And I could read the guy's lips. And one of them said, one of them put his head down like this. And the other one, I could read the lips, said, "I can't believe this is happening to us again." And I tell you what, I walked so fast, and I got to where the media room was, and I said, "What happened?" And they started explaining Jimmy Butler did this, and they got a layup, and Kawhi missed a free throw, and it's now 91-91 or something like that, or tie 90-90. Game. 90-90, yeah. Or the tie game. And so I walked straight to the video room. That's where I always watch it. And that's where that play came up. And Ernie, I stood up. I watched it with my assistant GM, Dan Tolsman, and our two video guys. And I watched the games there because I have all these screens so I can see replays. And if I need to walk into the arena, it's just a two-second walk right there to the tunnel. And as soon as he shot the ball, I stood up. And all I was thinking was overtime. Okay, it bounced really high, and we're going into overtime. They won't have enough time to get a shot. And it bounced, and second bounce, and then it started to die, and it went in. And I'm telling you, there was that minute of silence, and just an unbelievable feeling, Ernie. And the last thing I didn't add in your previous question, and you are absolutely right, you need luck. In this NBA, I don't care who you are, how good you are, you need luck. You need plenty of luck. And Kawhi is a great player, but from that to Kevin Durant being hurt or Klay Thompson or those things to fall your way, you know, like, why not stupid and naive to think that we didn't work hard enough, but why not naive and stupid to think that I'm doing something here.
It's quite all right.
Can you say hi? Say hi. Hey. You don't want to say hi, so close the door then.
Who was that? Who was that Masai?
That was Ding Ding.
That's Masai Junior. What's Ding Ding mean?
Yeah, Ding Ding is his middle. Masai is his first name, and his middle name is Dean, and so we call him Ding Ding. That's Masai.
So this is the guy who's going to marry Kawhi Leonard's daughter someday,
yes.
Correct?
Yes. Okay. And by the way, he was on FaceTime with her yesterday. Oh, yes, my wife and Ramatou still, I have a great relationship with Kawhi, but my wife and Kishel, I have a really, really close relationship. And wow. he talks to her every now and then.
That's a really cool point, because I think when you see a team part company with somebody, you know, and it was just a magical year that Kawhi spent with the Raptors. But that in these circumstances now, that there are moments like that where your family and his family will connect.
Yeah, it's great. You know, like I always say, Ernie, the two hardest things in our world, you know, and in our business and in what we do is trading a player and then when a player leaves. So if a player leaves in free agency, and it's hard on both sides, right? So when a player is traded, it's hard on the player side. And then when a player leaves, like us, it's hard on that side. I've experienced, you know, like all of it, you know, from and wonderful people, you know, and it sometimes put a strain on relationships, as we saw, you know, with DeMar. Even people don't know, too, even with Rudy Gay, you know, like I was close to Rudy, you know, like an incredible kids with DeMar, where you build, you're trying to preach a culture of good, of trust, of being with people, and then you have to make these decisions. And with Kawhi, we just built a relationship where, you know, like we trusted each other, and that friendship has evolved even, you know, even bigger, you know, like that he left, and I'm proud of that. I support him with everything he does as a human being and with his family, and you know, you move on, you got to move on and on to the next.
Well, you know, it was the same kind of thing. I mean, this is not an easy job, Masai. Anybody who thinks that it is, you know, is sadly mistaken, because you are dealing in that interpersonal relationship. And here was you fired Dwayne Casey, who you said was a father figure to you, and he was a coach of the year, but the team hadn't gotten to that point, but you had to do that. How do you prepare yourself to have those conversations?
Oh man, it's not easy, Ernie, you know, like if you have that human part of you, you know, you feel it in your heart, you know, like I want to say, you know, if you are a good human being, you know, these things, I will never ever forget, you know, having to do that with Coach Casey, and walking to his office, waking up that morning, you know, like, and I many times I wanted to move it and change it, or think that you're not making the right decision. It was incredibly hard, because Casey is an unbelievable person. Best, it's so great to work with, you know. And it had just reached a point with DeMar. I tell the story of how I was walking. I was in the hotel in Kenya, and I walked around that hotel at 5 a.m. 4 a.m. in the morning, for a couple hours, trying to gather up enough strength to and courage to make this phone call. And I'll never forget it. And you know, I hope with Casey it's gotten so much better now with his family and him. You know, with DeMar, there's still plenty of work to be done, but by the grace of God, it'll all get better. We have to continue to make these decisions. They are tough, you know, but that's the business of basketball and the positions that we're in.
Are there tears in a situation like that?
Yeah, they are. When I walked out of Coach Casey's office, you know, like I cried when I spoke to DeMar. I cried, you know. It's tough. It's tough, Randy. It's just, we all have human sides to us, you know. And you think of those situations we've built, we've fought wars, adversity, you know, like together 5 years, you know, like just going to those battles, you know, and. There were good ones, there were bad ones, there were painful ones, and we fought it all together. And at a point, you know, like it just looked like it wasn't going to work out, and something had to give.
You know, I spent the weekend, I was binge watching a few things, but at the same time, I was reading so many articles about you and watching some videos. And Toronto Life Magazine, Trevor Cole, I want to give Trevor Cole credit because they did an outstanding piece about you a couple of years ago, I think it was. But I would, your story is just amazing when I think about, you know, you in Nigeria and picking up a basketball, and here's this coach, Oliver Johnson, who's kind of pouring into you, and, you know, here you are trying to get a look at the NBA by looking at VHS tapes. And I mean, do you, how often, Masai, do you sit there like you are right now and say, how did this happen? How did I get to this place from that place?
Yeah, even now, Ernie, you know, when I drive home from work, I pinch myself every day, you know, that we're absolutely blessed. I'm so thankful to the NBA for giving me such a remarkable opportunity, starting with Basketball Without Borders. And whether it was...
Yeah, because that was your original link to the league, was Basketball Without Borders, correct? Which led to the initiative, the Giants of Africa. So,
yes.
Yeah, so from that beginning, and I'm sorry to interrupt, but I wanted to just interject that, but continue from, so here are Basketball Without Borders, and now it starts to take off for you.
Yeah, so with the opportunity, I got a call from Kim Bohoni and Amadou Fall, and I had stopped playing in Europe and was trying to get into college coaching, and I get a call from them, and they asked me to help them select the top 100 kids in Africa, because I was coaching the Nigerian junior national team. And unbelievable opportunity that that gave me to travel the continent. And the NBA would always call me to do little camps, right? USA, the U.S. Embassy envoy camps. I'd always be involved, you know, and I really appreciate and thank them for giving me that platform, and just fell in love with scouting and started to grow, Ernie, and started to build and meet people. And you serve. It's important that you serve. It's important that you respect the game in the NBA. It's important you respect the players. It's important that you respect the people that come before you. Yeah, very, very important. And I tried to serve that way while maybe developing a niche with scouting in Africa and in Europe and South America and Asia, and just traveling around the world. And I said to my wife the other day, this is the first time I've actually stood still in 20 years. It's the first time, you know, like that. I haven't, an airport is not part of my every couple of days or every few days, you know, going from one place to the other. And Ernie, I just got a huge chance. Adam Silver has been an incredible friend to me. I'm very biased with, and a lot of members of the NBA. They've really helped me grow, you know, as not only as a person, but in this business. You can't imagine, Ernie, I'm an alternate governor with my team, so I go to the board of governors meetings with ownership, and you cannot imagine, you know, like going from being that 13-year-old boy to now sitting down in those meetings, mm-hmm. to watching those VHS tapes. And then now in the meetings, Michael Jordan will come and he's always rubbing my head every time he walks by. And I'm thinking, that's the guy I watched, my idol, somebody I grew up idolizing, or during the GM meetings when Larry Bird was president. These are the guys, or Magic Johnson, who's become a personal friend. Or Charles Barkley, you know, like Kenny, all these guys, you know, like, I hate to, you know, give these names like that, but you think about it, Ernie, like me from Northern Nigeria to come to this, man, you know, like, we're blessed, you know, like, and I'm really thankful. And it's at this time you think about it, and I have to work harder. That's all I think every day, is I have to work harder. and be better when this is all over.
Describe for me what it was like last year after the season to go back to Africa, as you always do, to go to these camps where you're teaching the game to the kids, but you're teaching, there's so many life lessons that you're imparting with them. But at the same time, when you walk with the Larry O'Brien trophy and lock eyes with your old coach, the guy who introduced you to the game, and then to sit in your mom and dad's place with this trophy, can you even put into words the significance of that in your life?
Going home was incredible. To take that trophy to Africa, to not only to show my parents or show Coach OBJ, but to tell all those youth, you know, like that, man, they are way smarter than me. They are way better than me as basketball players. There are so many people that maybe one day can create a path. And they can honestly say, you know what, they can do it. And I believe they can do it, you know. And it's all in all walks of life, Ernie, regardless, whether it's as a player, manager, scout, coach, whether it's in all other different parts of the business that sports has created for us. I'm proud of the other Africans, you know, like that paved the way for us. Dikembe Mutombo, Hakeem Olajuwon, Manute Ball, and all these guys that continue to do much, you know, Joel Embiid, Pascal Siakam, what Luol Deng, Luke Bamute, all these guys have done, you know, like I'm so proud. I'm so proud of them. Giannis is how when I get into trouble when I call him Nigerian, so I'll say half Nigerian.
you know the that's how special it must be to have Pascal Siakam as part of that championship team and having an all-star year this year, because he was one of those faces in those Giants of Africa, on those courts that you were trying to infuse with this belief. And then there he is.
Well, you talk about Pascal, you talk about Joel Embiid, you talk about Luke Mbamute. Those guys went through Basketball Without Borders. And I think what the NBA has done with this program has been incredible. And that gave us the energy and the creativity to even start, you know, Giants of Africa. To tell you, Ernie, how much talent there is on that continent, Pascal, I couldn't tell if Pascal was an NBA player at Basketball Without Borders. I couldn't tell if Embiid was an NBA player at Basketball Without Borders. And I just wonder, you know, like as we continue to develop the game over there, how many kids are going to come out of this. But Pascal has been incredible. His growth as a basketball player, but even better as a person, a teammate. You know, it's wonderful to really see him take this stage. I will say this, Ernie, he's one of those kids that always told me, you know, I don't want to be a role player. I don't want to be labeled in the NBA as a rebounder and as a shot blocker. I want to be a superstar in the NBA. And he fought for it, and you could see he was always thriving for that. So really, really hats off to him for the hard work he's put in.
I know we're running a little short of time here. I do want to hit a couple other things, though, because I know leadership is huge for you. I know that you study that. I know that it is very important how you lead an organization or lead players. Pete Babcock's been a friend of mine for a long, long time. And I've been doing this inside the NBA thing for 30 years. Among the people I've met and enjoyed their friendship is Pete Babcock. And I didn't know that Pete Babcock basically allowed you to meet Nelson Mandela for the first time. Tell that story.
Incredible. I was with Basketball Without Borders, and I think it was 2004. We had a chance to go meet Nelson Mandela, but I think the NBA could only take a certain number. I think it might have been six people. And so we all, I think we might have done some kind of like a ballot and people were chosen. And I wasn't among that was chosen. And Pete Backup, bless his heart, incredible person. And an incredible person came to me and he said, it's so important to you, for me, to allow you to go and meet somebody like this who means incredibly much to all of us, but I know means so much to you. And Ernie, it changed my life. It changed my life. I grew up watching the news with my dad when there's fire in Soweto, you know, like, and I'd watch the news, you know, like, it's almost like these times we watch the news. It was watching, you know, like a war on your TV, you know, like, and then as I grew up, I started studying Nelson Mandela. And then here I am with an opportunity to meet him. What an incredible opportunity for me. And as soon as I walked into that room with Dikembe Mutombo, we stood in the corner and Nelson Mandela came up to us and he went to Mutombo and he said, what a great thing you do for your people in the continent of Africa. Don't ever stop. That inspired me. He looked at me and he said, that's a great smile you have, young man. And the second time I saw him, he remembered me, which is incredible for me. But to see two people like that, Nelson Mandela in this big space and Dikembe Mutombo in his space building the hospital, and then all the leaders, you know, like I've met in Africa that are doing incredible things, you know, like just from this, whether it's President Kagame in Rwanda or Kenyatta in Kenya or Buhari in Nigeria, these guys, that gave me that opportunity. So I'm so grateful for Pete Babcock, bless his heart, for doing that for me. And every day I know I remember this.
Lastly, I don't know what your gut feeling is on how we're going to play basketball again. You know, do you have any ideas on if we do get back, how we should play this out?
You know, we all have tons of ideas, you know, and I think first of all, I commend Adam Silver, you know, for making that decision. You know, Ernie, I was in the NBA offices having a meeting with him few weeks before all of this, you know, and Adam, it was four or five of us. It was an NBA Africa board meeting. And after the meeting, Adam started talking about this virus and the way he talked about it and how passionate he was, you know, like about where this thing was going. Was incredible to see. And in my mind, you know, like I tell my wife this, you know, like, and now I'm telling the whole world this, you know, I can't believe it. And I was like, man, why is he being so dramatic about this? You know, like almost like, yeah, you think like that, you know, and this is how serious this is. This is how we have to pay attention to this and stay home and social distance and just practice social distancing. And he had the foresight, you know, like he had the vision. And you think it's not only him starting this for the league, you know, like for other leagues, it opened up a whole can in this world, you know, like it opened it up clearly. And that's leadership, you know, like that is leadership. And I know with all the input, his leadership team in the NBA and how he directs and how leads, he'll come up with something great, you know, like, and he's taking all our inputs. I am confident, you know, like that we'll get back playing in some kind of way, Ernie. And we miss the game, man. We miss sports. We miss the game, you know. And when they told me I was going to come on and do this with you, something came to my mind, and I got to say it, you know. After I watch our games, you know, like I drive home, and I either do two things. If my wife is still awake, we go up in bed, and and we just watch you guys and we laugh. We laugh and we cry with laughter. Or I go down to my basement if she's asleep and do the same thing and laugh. I watch other games and just laugh. I miss that. You know, I miss everything, the people. The NBA is such an incredible family. We compete against each other, you know, like we fight each other, you know, like to win. But at the end of the day, it's an incredible family, you know, like, and God bless the whole world. God bless the NBA. God bless sports, you know, like, and God bless the people that are going through this in a tough way. You know, like, we have to keep praying for them. So thank you. Thank you, Ernie.
No, I appreciate it. And I appreciate the fact that you watch the show. But if you really like it that much, then stop offering to mentor Kenny Smith into a into a front office. What are you trying to break up the show?
That's my guy, man. That's my guy. Charles Barkley too. I love you guys, man. It's awesome. Yeah. It's really cool. And he'll be back. We'll be back. We shall fight through this together. You know, like, we'll get through this and we'll be right back. We'll be right back at it again.
Hey, Masai, I congratulate you on your success, and I appreciate your passion. And what are you, 6'4", 6'5"?
6'5" on a good day.
6'5" on a good, that qualifies as a giant in this business for me. And you're exactly right. Keep that up. And thank you so much for sharing your story, man. It's a great one. And I look forward to a time when we'll be able to see each other face to face again. Thanks so much.
Thank you. Thanks for having me, Ernie. I really appreciate it. Thank you.